The Sikorsky R-4, or VS-316A, was the penultimate iteration of Igor Sikorsky's pre-war vision for the world's first practical helicopter. And in 1944, the R-4 became the first military helicopter to ever be placed in production. The helicopter was used in World War II by the U.S. Army, U.S. Navy, and the British Royal Navy. Although primitive in technology and limited by weight and range, the Sikorsky R-4 proved its worth in the Burma Campaign during the war. It was a versatile aircraft supporting the legendary British Chindits, a long-range penetration special operations force. The jungle environment would push the helicopter to its limits as it carried out secret missions up to 150 miles behind enemy lines. The VS-300. The mastermind behind the first mass-produced helicopter was Igor Sikorsky. Born in Kiev, Russia in 1889, Sikorsky made himself a name in the Tsar's court and the military elite as a pioneer in aircraft designs. When Tsarism came to an end in 1917 with the beginning of the Russian Revolution, Sikorsky made his way to the US, where he established a company in 1923. After creating the S-42 flying boat, Sikorsky resumed the work of an ambitious project of his own, one that he had cherished since his days in Russia, the helicopter. The VS-300 was his first successful attempt at creating a fully functional helicopter prototype. Although there were other German designs on the market by the time Sikorsky created the VS-300, he was the first to introduce a tail rotor to counter the torque effect that caused the helicopter's fuselage to rotate opposite to the spinning rotor above. The VS-300 has a single three-blade rotor powered by a 75-horsepower engine via a belt reduction drive, giving an adequate performance to the 1,100-pound aircraft. Due to weight limitations, it could only be piloted by one man. A VS-300 with utility floats attached became the first practical amphibious helicopter for use overseas in 1941. It beat the world endurance record held by the 1937 German Focke-Wulf FW-61 by staying aloft for 1 hour and 32 minutes. This model proved Sikorsky's principles of helicopter design. A three-bladed rotor with cyclic pitch control and a tail rotor for anti-torque effect were the requirements for a successful machine to fly without any problems. Design and development of the R-4. The Vought Sikorsky XR-4 design would emerge from the VS-300. Originally designated VS-316, it was later renamed the XR-4 when the Army adopted it in 1942. Sikorsky began to develop the XR-4 when the U.S. Army Air Corps asked him to produce a more advanced version of his VS-300 helicopter. The goal was to compete with the Platt LePage XR-1 that the Air Corps wanted to get rid of for its technical limitations. In December 1940, the Air Corps awarded Sikorsky a $50,000 contract to initiate the new aircraft's development. Like the VS-300, the helicopter's fuselage featured a steel tube framework. Everything but the extreme rear end of the aircraft was fabric covered, as were the 10.97-meter diameter main rotor blades. The fabric-covered rotors were 38 feet in diameter and turned counterclockwise. A new addition was a fully enclosed cabin with two-man seating and dual controls for both. The three-blade tail rotor lay to the right of the tail boom in a tractor configuration and rotated clockwise when seen from the left side. It was powered by a 165-horsepower Warner R-503 engine. The aircraft was 33 feet 11 inches long and 12 feet 5 inches tall. It weighed 2,010 pounds empty, and its maximum gross weight was 2,540 pounds. On May 17, 1942, after 761 miles of flying over 5 days that began in Stratford, Connecticut, test pilot Charles Lester Morris and Sikorsky himself arrived at Wright Field, Dayton, Ohio, to deliver the U.S. Army's first helicopter. Morris flew directly to the base administration building and landed there. Both men were greeted by a large group of people, all of whom were astonished by the strange vehicle. One of those people was Lieutenant Colonel Hollingsworth Franklin Gregory, the Army's designated rotorcraft expert and future legend of the Burma Campaign during World War II. The XR-4 exceeded all the previous helicopter endurance, altitude, and airspeed records that had been set before it. With an estimated helicopter peak altitude record of 12,000 feet and top airspeed approaching 90 miles per hour, the newer model outpowered the VS-300 in every single way. Nonetheless, the limited weight the R-4 could carry resulted in a fuel capacity problem, and consequently a range problem. The distance from Connecticut to Ohio had to be covered in 16 separate flights, with every flight session lasting roughly 1 hour. In January 1943, the U.S. Army ordered 29 prototypes. The first three were designated YR-4A. The second prototype benefited from an upgraded 180-horsepower Werner R-551 engine, and a rotor diameter that was increased by 1 foot. Tests demonstrated a need for further improvements, such as increasing the fuel capacity by at least 5 U.S. gallons. Out of the 100 R-4B built, 35 of them were delivered to the U.S. Air Force for observation duties, and 20 to the U.S. Navy as an air-sea rescue aircraft. The remaining 45 were sent to Great Britain under Lend-Lease, most of them going to the Royal Navy. The British nicknamed their R-4s the Hoverfly 1. In May 1943, the aircraft also demonstrated its capabilities for serving in the sea. Sikorsky fitted the plane with pontoon floats to prove that it could both take off and land from the water. Colonel Gregory then used XR-4 to conduct tests designed to show that helicopters could protect convoys, conduct anti-submarine patrols, and land at ship decks without any problems. All results were positive. The Commando Air Unit. The Sikorsky R-4 saw combat in the Pacific Theater during the last years of World War II. In 1944, several aircraft were sent to Burma as part of the Commando Air Unit. In 1943, U.S. Air Force Lieutenant Colonel John Allison went to Wright Field in Dayton, Ohio, to see the helicopter in action. He was convinced by the machine and concluded that it could help with the Japanese in Burma. Chief Henry Hap Arnold enlisted Colonel Allison and his friend Phil Cochran in a top-secret project to build the first U.S. group of air commandos. Chief Arnold described the commando's role as, quote, pilots who would insert, supply, protect, and extract ground forces in the Burmese jungle, deep behind enemy lines. Both soldiers were attracted to the idea of this new force. However, the problem was convincing the Army and the Air Corps to use the prototypes before the war ended. A manager at Wright Field told Allison, quote, they're not ready for real-world conditions. The rotor blades are laminated, wood pieces glued together. In the hot climate you want to take them to, they're liable to come apart. There's just so much we don't know about them. Allison, trying to convince the manager, told him that Burma's operation could help Sikorsky raise more funds for the program. He said to the manager, quote, we can take 6 of your helicopters and your testing gear to India and test them in real conditions. Then we'll go rescue some people in the jungle who are in real trouble. That will get Sikorsky great publicity. But the manager was not convinced. At the same time, his friend Cochran traveled to England to meet the commander of the British Special Force in Asia, Ord Wingate. Wingate, an irregular warfare expert, had recently returned from a punishing guerrilla raid into Burma, where his forces had managed to penetrate 200 miles into the jungle. Wingate had recently created the Chindits, a special operations unit of the British and Indian armies, technically known as long-range penetration groups. This force conducted sabotage operations deep behind enemy lines, causing headaches with the Japanese supply lines. Allison and Cochran established their air commando unit and an armada of more than 300 aircraft in a month. They counted on 13 C-47s and 150 gliders to fly the Chindits and their mules into the jungles of Burma. Additionally, a squadron of 30 P-51A fighters and 13 B-25 Mitchell bombers would provide the artillery for the ground troops, alongside a light airplane force of 100 Stinson L-5 Sentinels and 20 Stinson L-1 Vigilants to evacuate the wounded back to India. All that was missing was the helicopter, but they did not know where it would fit. After flying back to the U.S., Allison, counting on Chief Arnold's support, convinced a generals panel that the helicopters were necessary for defeating the Japanese in southern Asia. A shoebox with windows was how one of the attendants described the Sikorsky R-4 when he saw it for the first time. When they finally got the green light, the Air Commando Unit began moving the aircraft to India in November 1943. Operations in Burma. Of the 6 helicopters given to Allison, one was lost in a thunderstorm, and another arrived without a tail rotor. Each R-4 had to be transported to a Curtiss C-46. Operations began in 1944. Allison later recalled the fuel problems of the R-4 during flights. He said, quote, When we got the air commando into the jungle, the fighting we were doing was 150 miles behind Japanese lines. The helicopters wouldn't go 150 miles. To get to our airfield in the jungle, the helicopter pilot had to stack the passenger seat with tins of petrol, fly halfway, and then find an open area and land to refuel. The first rescue operation of an R-4 was in April 1944. An L-1 Vigilant was shot down, carrying three wounded British soldiers and the pilot. Only a small plane could land on the place where the wounded were hiding. That was the call of the Egg Beater to the rescue, as the men liked to call the helicopters. As the R-4 could only carry one person at a time for its weight and space capabilities, Herman, the Air Corps pilot chosen for the operation, would need to make four trips from the jungle to a nearby clearing. Once in open ground, L-5s could carry the wounded to base. Herman stripped his R-4 of excess weight, loaded four jerry cans of fuel, and set out on April 25th. After successfully finding the wounded men in the jungle, the R-4 made its way back to base, where Herman was greeted as a hero. The incredible rescue of four men from the Japanese army showed the U.S. Air Corps what a helicopter could do. The air commandos flew 20 more rescues before their helicopters wore out in Burma. They were used in other theaters of the war, but only in Burma were they used in combat conditions. From that point on, the helicopter went on to become one of the most indispensable and versatile aircraft used in military and civilian operations to this day.